Thank you. Thank you so much. In fact, the briefing, the little briefing that Lucky has just given has touched on a lot of nerves in me, where I have not been long in the system. There are people that are 10 years and above still who are in the system. But in particular, I will share a story of when I got to Monaghan and how I got myself hooked up with the movement of asylum seekers. I came from town that evening, and two young ladies, one from Zimbabwe and one from Ghana, had just come from school because they attended Cavern Institute. It was winter, it was early January. And as I walked in, I found clothes outside, in front of their room. And this is outside, and it is winter, and it is dark. And these are two young ladies in their early 20s. To me, they would be girls. They would be my daughter's age. And I was like, and you, in the cold, at night? And they said, you've been put out. But at night? And they said, yes. I said, and what is the crime? What happened? And they were like, our crime is going to school, attending Cavern Institute. And so you have to sleep out. And they said, our beds have been taken because we did not sleep in the center for 2 nights. Because it's so expensive to travel between Monaghan and Cavern, these girls would, you know, make friends at school and would be sleeping by the friends' houses 1 or 2 nights to make sure that they are able to fit into the 19 euros, the trip, weekly trips to school, because they were paying on their own. And there they were at night. I couldn't walk upstairs to my room. I just couldn't. These were kids, these were children to me. And I couldn't watch this situation. I called the Gada. Gada came. It's like, this is the situation. And they asked them why they were there. They said exactly what they had said to me. Gada bought into their car and they drove away. It was at that night that I went through, I googled through, and I was looking for any organization that could help. I looked for the Irish Refugee Council, I looked for everything, and I was phoning any number that was there to say, here is a situation. I've got these two girls that I've put out, they are without accommodation. It is cold, it is snowing, it was actually snowing that evening, and they had no accommodation because the center had put them out. And as I was going through, Googling and talking to people, I then got Lucky's number. And I phoned to say, Lucky, we are in trouble here. We've got kids that we don't know where to put them tonight. Those two girls took the 10:30 bus from Monaghan to Dublin, which gets to Dublin at about 12:30. And Lucky made means to meet them at night, like after midnight. And I asked myself, if it's just for going to school, these kids have to suffer this way. And then I followed up that there were stories of, and by the way, when the manager got back to the office in the morning and heard that I interfered into this, he called me and held me on the shoulder like a little boy. And he said to me, you dare interfere into residence issues here. If you want to get your papers in Ireland, behave yourself. And I pushed his hand and I was like, how old are you? Do you see who you're talking to? Am I not an adult? And I could see the way he was opening his eyes. It was the first time he was challenged ever by an asylum seeker. That's the attitude that the center management, the center administrators, the center administration has towards the people that live there. They are treated like children, let alone children, like people that work in their back gardens or wherever. And irrespective of how old you are just a little. In fact, I also picked up that we are never called by names. We are just numbers. In these centers, you know, when they know your name, you are lucky. Because you are a number. And they're not dealing with a person here. They're dealing with numbers. What I can say for and about direct provision is that it is not good for any purpose. I'm happy today that I'm talking to young people. And I'm telling this story to young people. I'm telling this story to the future of the state, which is youngsters. It's a pity that this state has always had that black mark on the way they do things. They've had previously the Magdalene sisters. These things have been happening, and they've gotten rid of them. Remember in the Kenny, you know, emotional and sobbing about that in the States. Sobbing about the issue of the Magdalene situation. But still, this new government still has this black mark, which is direct provision, which I know in the future, one of the anti-shock, again, will be emotional about it and sorry about it. And I hope and believe that the young people of Ireland will always know that there has always been this bad thing, which, and that they will want not to have this in the future. It is still happening right now. I hope it will not happen with the future Ireland, with the future young people of Ireland. And I'm very grateful that we've been welcome. Talking about the two ladies that were put out at night in Monaghan, I then developed the age, the zeal about education. I started thinking, if for education these people are going to suffer, I wonder what the people of the area are thinking about, what the people of the area are saying about this. I got to meet the TD. I got to talk to Heather Humphreys, TD in the area, and I got to talk to the CEO of the county council. And I related the stories. And they were all like, we can't do anything. It's the law. It's the law. But I am still today involved, and I still talk. I now sit in the PPN, Public Participation Network, and we pass the stories. And we then formed what we call the Monaghan Innovation Support Group, which I happen to be vice chairman. And we work on these issues. But life out there in direct provision is not a walk on the roses. It is very difficult for people. Segregation, racism, discrimination are things we face every day. It's actually normal, so normal that people don't think they have to stand up because it's something that happens every day. And honestly, if they were to stand up against these three, segregation, racism, discrimination, then there would be no one living in the center because people would be staying in the courts. They'd be in court every day to be talking about these issues. I guess this is a national concern which the state should work on because it is there, it exists. And direct provision is just tailored that way.